Hello and let's talk about this supposed festival bonanza for government employees. Yesterday, newspapers were wildly celebrating this so-called bonanza announced by the government for its employees. According to these papers, nearly 31 lakh non-gazetted government and public undertaking staff were to get a festival bonus that amounted to ₹3,737 crore. Now, the bulk of this amount, that's 2,791 crore, is for nearly 16.97 lakh employees of institutions like the railways and the postal services, while the rest will go for nearly 13.7 lakh employees of the central government. This announcement seems pretty impressive on the face of it, until you go into the fine print, of course, and then you realize that there's nothing unique or special, but this is something given every year. Similarly, last week, Finance Minister Nirmala Sitharaman made announcements regarding a leave travel cash voucher and a festival advance for central government employees. Again, there is much behind the obvious in these announcements. We talked to journalist Anindya Chakravarti to find out what is behind these announcements.
Thank you, Anindya, for joining us. So yesterday we saw newspapers, especially the financial newspapers, declare a bonanza. And that was a word almost universally used among all the media organizations. And we had complaints. We've talked about all this while the government refusing to, you know, spend money to stimulate demand. And it's been this thing. And the media seems to embrace that narrative, saying how the government has done this. But if you go a bit into the fine print, was this exactly such a big or significant announcement?
You know, it actually tells you about two things. One is that it's possible that our news media editors are and journalists are complicit, right? They want to sell everything as a great big achievement of the government. It is a possibility. I'm not discounting that. We know that happens. But I think there's also basic illiteracy here. They don't even do a Google search to find out a basic thing. Is it paid every year, right? Even if you don't know and you're a reporter, we were trained, Prashant, to do a Google search or to look up the back issues and find out whether this is a new thing. Exactly. This is paid every year. In fact, this year it is delayed. It has been delayed this year. Railway employees have been getting this performance-linked bonus and non-PLB, which is for non-gazetted officers from all kinds of they've been getting it since 1979-1980. There is nothing new in it. In 2017-18, 2018-19, they were given 2,044 crore, just railway employees. I think they were about 11 lakh out of the 30.6 lakh that we're talking about, who were given 2,044 crore. Now add up all the others, and I'm sure it'll come right to that same number, maybe a little bit increased because of inflation. But otherwise, it's broadly the same amount which was given last year, which is budgeted for, because broadly it would be budgeted for, because bonuses have to be given. They are given. It's part of the deal of the jobs that are being given to people. Whether it's in coal mines, whether it is in other places, bonuses are paid, right? So it is part of the budgeting exercise itself. At least a band would have to be cleared for those payments to take place. So which is why every year, if you do a Google search, you'll find it for every single year around this time, before Dashera, before Diwali, before Durga Puja, bonuses are paid. The cabinet approves a certain amount. Usually it is 72 to 78 days. That is what has been done again this year. And our newspapers make that the front headline. They will not tell you, Prashant, and that I'm sure that you are aware of, that railway employees were threatening to go on strike. They were going to go on strike from yesterday, and they've now withheld that strike. They're not going because the bonus has been announced, because it was delayed. That particular news item was probably hidden in one of the inside pages of their own papers. Right? Maybe some PTI news which was put in there to fill a small block, which was an ad didn't come in or a classified didn't come in. So they looked for something and put that in. Right? So, you know, yesterday I tweeted that if only they read their own papers, they would realize that it's not new.
Exactly.
So that's what I'm saying. I mean, it's amazing that it should be passed off as a fiscal stimulus or some bonanza.
Right. It's basically more or less like saying that salaries are coming in on the first this month.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah. Right. It's exactly. It's like saying that every time someone, if you pay the person who comes to wash the dishes in your house, their salary, they should be very grateful and say, thank you so much. Aapne mujhe itna bada tohfa diya hai. It's like that. I mean, it's a joke, really.
Exactly. Right. And in this context, I also wanted to talk about two announcements Finance Minister Nirmala Sitharaman made last week, which again were kind of quite celebrated. One was regarding a leave travel cash voucher. and the other was regarding a festival advance. So could you first maybe talk about the leave, this the LTA system itself? Again, it's, I guess it's also interesting because for most people in the private sector, there is no real concept of, at least for many people, there's no concept of this thing. So it seems like something very innovative. So,
my parents were the university teachers. So we got LTC, and there was also something else called home travel allowance, I think, where people could visit their home. It was assumed that they've come to Delhi or some city to work, and you got a train fare. The entire family got back and forth. So in a 4-year chunk, you got to take HTA and LTA. Now, LTA was something that you took when you took a holiday. And because of LTA, actually people have traveled, government employees have traveled across India. They've taken train trips, traveled to different parts of India, seen things across India. And this is actually one of the, I would say, one of the social initiatives of the government to encourage people to know their own country, take holidays, right? And now LTA can be taken, I think, in 4-year, there are 4-year cycles in which it is announced. So there's a 2018 to 2021 cycle right now. Once, if you don't take it, it lapses, right?
You just to sort of clarify, by LTA, you mean that when you go on leave, your tickets are paid for by the government or the organization.
And that particular expenditure, because ultimately it is part of your, it's something that you've earned, right?
Yeah.
That particular expenditure, you get a tax rebate on that.
Yeah.
Now, most corporate organizations also give you an LTA. For instance, where I worked, I had an LTA. If I did not take it, it came into my salary, but I had to pay full tax on it. If I could give tickets and say, this is where I've traveled and say that this is the time when I took leave, I took leave and these are the tickets that I spent on, that particular amount of expenditure would become tax exempt. So that would go into the tax exempt category. So that is actually available to private employees as well. Now, the point is that the government is saying, okay, this year because of COVID, maybe people are not being able to travel and their money will lapse, right? So on the face of it, this is, and therefore, instead of that, we are going to give them, let them encash it. They can take that amount which they would have spent on a ticket. They'll get that money. And also, if they've taken a 15-day leave, that they're now not going to take it. If they don't take it, they can encash that leave. A lot of private companies don't have this leave encashment system. They tell you, you have to take leave. A lot of private companies do have a leave encashment system. Now, the government also is saying, okay, you can encash that leave. Take that amount and this is yours and it will also be tax-free. There's still some issue about whether it will be tax-exempt.
Right.
The interesting thing is, Prashant, on the face of it, when I first saw it, I said, okay, good. The government is doing, you know, it might still be part of the budgeted process itself because ultimately governments probably, all government departments estimate how many people are likely to take and that's part of the money they want to be budgeted for there. Now, the issue is that the government is saying, no, you have to spend 3 times that amount to get the money. So if you were traveling to, let's say, Kerala from Delhi back and forth, and you get, I think, AC 2-tier tickets, let's say that for the family, the total return would come to, I don't know, let's say 20,000 rupees. You'd be able to tell me better about that. But 20,000 rupees, let's say you and you encash your leave, let's say another 10,000 rupees. So 30,000 rupees is the amount that you would be available to you in LTA. I'm taking a large amount here, right? You will have to spend 90,000 rupees to take advantage of that 30,000 rupees. Why would you do it?
Right.
Only if you were already planning to buy a lot of things, right? Only if you're planning to buy a car or a big LCD, LED TV, which costs a lot of money, or the latest refrigerator. I don't know whether 90,000 rupee refrigerator, but even if someone was going to spend 15,000 rupees, they would still have to spend 45,000 rupees to be able to buy, to take advantage of this thing. Mm-hmm. So therefore, this essentially is telling people, we are going to give 1/3 the amount, which was already you were going to get. You can take it in 2021 also, but here, take this 1/3, spend 3 times. Who is it going to benefit, Prashant? That's a question I would like to ask you. Who benefits from this extra spending?
So when we are looking, it would probably be, say, the very organized sector, maybe the biggest corporates, because that amount of expenditure is involved.
Because there is also one more caveat. I mean, it's not even that you can say that, okay, I'm going to get my house painted by the local painter. No.
Right.
The caveat is that everything you spend has to be spent on things which pay at least 12% GST. So 12%, 18%. Now, we know that very small entrepreneurs are exempt from GST registration, right? They don't have to. If they have a 40 lakh turnover in a year, they don't have to register for GST.
Right.
And that means that anything that you buy from the smallest of entrepreneurs cannot be done using this particular money that has been given to you. This can only be spent largely on what we call white goods or consumer durables, right? This is what you spend on, provide the GST bill. Who gains from it? As you said, big corporates. Big corporates and big service providers, they are the people who gain. They are the people who are going to benefit from a one-third stimulus being given by the government of what people were going to get in any case.
Right.
Right.
Absolutely. And what about the advance as well? I believe that's also a similar attempt.
You know, it is, I have a driver who I constantly have to give advances to, and usually he never pays it back. So effectively, it becomes an additional bonus for him. But the advances that you pay, what is an advance? It is something that you're going to earn over the next few months.
Right.
Which you're taking in advance. Now, your employer is going to say when you take it in advance, you're effectively gaining because there's an interest loss that I have. If I had put that money in a bank, in a savings account, I would have got 3.5% interest. If I give that to you in advance for 1 year, let's say 6 months, I'm losing interest for 6 months.
Mm-hmm.
So what is the government losing by giving 10,000 rupees advance, a maximum of 10,000 rupees advance? It is in an annual cycle, it is losing 3.5%. In fact, Prashant, if government employees had to spend their own money, which is in the bank, to buy something for the festival season, they are effectively losing 3% interest because it was in the savings account. That means 300 rupees. So what is the government giving you in that advance? The advance that the government is giving you, the spending that the government is doing on you, the additional amount the government is giving is 300 rupees. 300, 350 rupees. And using that 300 rupees, it wants you to spend 10,000. So it is saying, here is a stimulus of this much. Please spend 33 times that much to make use of it.
Right.
So this is the greatest stimulus package possible, a multiplier effect of 30 to 33 times, right?
Right?
Of things which you've already budgeted.
Which you've already budgeted.
For. Yeah.
Exactly. Yeah. So it clearly kind of seems that all these announcements fit into a pattern which the government has been doing for many years, that first repackage whatever you already have, launch out a major publicity campaign, and in the end actually do not end up really spending too much. We saw the same thing with the COVID-19 stimulus package as well, which was tom-tom to the skies and nothing happened. And the total amount was way less.
Absolutely. In fact, you can see that the government is still going on about giving monetary stimulus, telling RBI to spend more. I think Shaktikanta Das has said that the worst is over, except that he said 9.5% contraction. So the worst is over. We are seeing, there seems to be a concentrated effort. Ever since the IMF came up with this thing that India's GDP is going to contract, and it's going to be the worst performing in this year.
Right.
I think there's been a concentrated effort to create a feel-good package. There's nothing wrong in that as long as you are also really spending.
Exactly.
When it is just empty, you're essentially giving the same money which you'd already budgeted, but you decided not to spend. There's another big story today in one of the pink papers saying government says departments can spend their budget.
Exactly.
Something like that. I mean, you have budgeted something, you're saying don't spend because of COVID, right? And now you're saying that, okay, go ahead and spend.
Yeah.
As if this is a massive stimulus.
Right. Right, exactly.
Hey, what can you say to that?
Hey, absolutely.
The only thing you can say is that governments will always spin. That is the job of a government, right?
Right.
It is for the media to point out that this is not true.
Exactly.
So the media is not going to do that.
Exactly. Right. In this context, I mean, I guess a lot of this really has to do with the question of demand itself, which we have been discussing. The fact that demand has been at historic lows and what needs to be done to kind of push this up. And this context, there's also been some news about car sales, for instance, picking up, mobile phone sales, for instance, picking up. So can these be posited as signs of some kind of a recovery, or is there a story behind that?
The story is the same as, let's take the mobile sales, the smartphone sales. Shipment, I think, for July to September has been the highest in ever. So I think some 50 lakh mobile phone, smartphones have been shipped. Right. Many of them in the below 12,000 rupee category, right? There's a side story here, which is that we are so anti-Chinese that the Chinese companies' share in the shipment has risen from 74% to 76% in the same July to September. Right. Let's look at the fact that, you know, when we saw mobile phones with everyone, this was seen as a sign of prosperity in India. And this is going on for the last 10 years. That Indians, everyone uses mobile phones. They've become so prosperous. The point is, this has become their office. More than 50% of Indians are self-employed, right? Some of them are agriculture. Okay, remove that part. But for those who are itinerant workers, plumbers, carpenters, electricians, hawkers, they no longer have the local store where they can go and sit or the local market where they can go and work. They are roaming around. They are called on the phone. So it is their office, which is why they formed that massive club called the Missed Call Club, where they give you a missed call that I've come and you have to call back. Right. So incoming is free. They don't want to spend. So therefore, I think that when you look at mobile phones, think of the stories, anecdotal information we have, that people are being forced to sell things, to buy smartphones for the children, because otherwise the children will not be able to get educated. Classes are being held online. So Zoom, Skype, these are the routes through which classes are being held. Right. And children of the poor are being forced to do it on smartphones. We know what happened in Delhi, where there was this girl who whose phone was being snatched by two people, and she ran after them. They were trying to, you know, stab her, and she held on to them till she got her phone back. She said, "My father bought this phone for my classes. I can't lose it." So to say that this is a sign of great prosperity is, I think, ridiculous. When it comes to cars, let's look at it. One of the things that we are seeing is that, and there's a story in one of the papers today or yesterday about how first-time owners has increased dramatically. In the last 2-3 years, we had been hearing that how people are switching to shared rides for all these large aggregators like Ola, Uber. People are using that, and it's true. Even someone like me, for some trips, I would say, okay, I'm not going to take my car. I'll do Ola and Uber. It was cheaper because it was being subsidized. Now, you look at it, that has stopped, right? You can see that even a company like Maruti is worried that the cars that it specifically created for these large aggregators. I think there was something called the Desire. I'm forgetting what the name is of a particular model, but it was largely created for these particular, and they're saying that these are not going to sell, right? So they're worried about that, and they're trying to think how to increase the sales of these particular variants. So we know that part is killed. So people are forced to buy cars because they don't trust public transport.
Right.
They're worried that if they take public transport, they'll be exposed to COVID, right? So they're buying cars. And some of it is replacement demand. But even replacement demand has actually dropped sharply this year. Most of it is first-time buyers who are saying, we have to buy cars because I can't afford to, or a bike. And if you look at April to September, there has been a sharp drop in total car sales. There has been a recovery in August and September, and maybe we'll see this recovery continue, partly because people need to buy cars because they don't trust public transport, and also because they didn't buy it from April to July.
Exactly. Right?
Every month, so many cars sell and they didn't sell. I mean, even Maruti's sales are down. If you take from April to September, I think it's down about 35%. Even though in August, September, there's been a gain compared to last year, significant gain in sales. So one has to remember these are all these are expenditures which are being done per force. They're forced upon people because of the situation they're finding themselves in.
Absolutely.
And given today, one of the newspapers has reported that there's been a big recovery in you know, people were not being paid salaries. There had been salaries cuts, but that has now recovered to a large extent. Now, when you always, one of the things that one always has to do is read the fine print, and you see that the fine print is essentially a few companies, and then it'll say 70% have got their salaries back. 70% have got part of their, some have got part of their salaries back. So I just did a Twitter poll this morning, and it's obviously a very small sample. It's a self-selecting sample. It's not, but it gives you some idea about what is happening. And I said that if you had a pay cut, this was only for those who had pay cut, and there are about 430 odd votes here. It was a 3-hour poll, right? And I can guarantee that the newspaper reports did not speak to 430 people, but still, right? I gave four options. Has your salary been fully reinstated? It has been partly reinstated. You're getting more than what you got before COVID, because we have to remember that April, May, June is the increment period, where people get hikes.
Right.
That did not come. Instead, they got pay cut. And not been reinstated. You're still facing a pay cut. 66% have voted that they have still not been reinstated. Here we saw that 70%, the report tells us 70% reinstated. In my unscientific poll, unscientific self-selecting poll, 66%. Discount that further. Make that 40%, right? But even then, anecdotal evidence tells us that in most places, it has not been reinstated. Fully reinstated, only 14%. Partly reinstated, 12%. More than pre-COVID levels, which means a salary hike, 8%. 8%. And most of it, I would assume, would have come from the financial sector.
Exactly.
And which is from brokerages and banks, which is what CMI's first amount of data tells us, that hikes have actually only taken place in COVID, in this period, in only these places. Everywhere else, there have been pay cuts.
Absolutely. Thank you so much, Anandya, for talking to us. We'll keep tracking these issues as they continue to happen and as more such reports keep coming out.
Thanks a lot, Prashant.
That's all we have time for today. We'll be back on Monday with more news from India and the world. Until then, keep watching NewsClick. You